started, so we're talking about the nucleus and cell division. And we also talk about the mitochondria after this. This one might go a little over an hour, but I'll try to keep the one, the mitochondria, under an hour, so it should even out. And as usual, like, you've got the electric components. We'll talk about the nuclear shape, the structure of the nucleus. Also the fact that the nuclei may differ in appearance between cells, depending on what cell you're looking at. And the way we're going to look at it is kind of going outwards from the interior of the nucleus, sort of starting with the nucleolus, and then ending up with the nuclear pores, which are the connections between the nucleus and the cytoplasm. There's various ways, you know, one could organize this, but I just, for the sake of simplicity, I kind of, you can visualize it as a journey of kind of going from the interior of the nucleus outwards. And I've sort of tried different ways, but this kind of works. And let's start with actual, just an overview of the nucleus. Like, what are some of the major things that you will see in the nucleus? Like a big fraction will be the nucleolus that I just mentioned. I'll talk about what that does in a moment. And then the other major component is the actual chromatin, you know, the nucleoplasm containing chromatin, containing DNA, of course. And there is basically two ways that chromatin is organized, the heterochromatin and the euchromatin, and I'll talk about the differences between the two. And then other aspects of the nucleus are the nuclear membrane, which basically separates the nucleus from the rest of the cell, from the cytoplasm. And then the nuclear pores are basically connections that allow import and export of proteins and RNAs and so on into the nucleus and out of the nucleus. So that's kind of like just an overview. And as I said, nuclei can differ quite dramatically in shape and appearance between cells. So here we've got various cell types here. You know, this is a histology image. It's not always going to be this complex. But this is just for the purposes of illustration. So you might have seen something like this in Dr. Heinbuckel's introduction to tissues lecture. You basically got a neuron here. And, So you've basically got a nucleus here with a neuron. With the nucleus and the nucleolus, and you can see that nucleus is pretty big and pale, and you've got a prominent nucleolus, and that differs markedly from the nuclei of these endothelial cells over here forming the blood vessel. So these nuclei are very flat and elongated, and you know, dramatic difference in the skeletal muscle. You have nuclei there off to the side, and also kind of flat. Here we have some glands where you have cuboidal epithelium. The nuclei are basically round and relatively darkly stained, relatively intense. And basically, yeah, just get the idea that you know, nuclei can, just like cells, can differ in appearance between different cell types. And also, even just the degree of staining can differ of the actual chromatin. So here we have a nucleus, again, of a neuron, and you can see the chromatin is pretty light. That's called, this is called euchromatin. And that means, generally speaking, that there's a lot of transcription going on in that material, in that chromatin. A lot of genes being transcribed. Over here we have heterochromatin, you know, these other cells. And that means that the DNA is condensed, that gene transcription is reduced in those cells. And that's like a general, pretty good rule of thumb, like that U chromatin is uncondensed DNA with a lot of transcription. Heterochromatin is condensed DNA with reduced transcription. And even within one nucleus, you're gonna see different proportions of U chromatin and heterochromatin. So even in a single nucleus, you see both, like heterochromatin and U chromatin, and I'll come back to that soon. But that this is just to give you the idea that nuclei differ in size, shape, staining of heterochromatin, U chromatin, and so on. Let's start going out, as I said, from the looking at these different components, starting in the middle, the interior. The first is the nucleolus, and that's a complex of proteins and RNAs, ribosomal RNAs, that form around the genes for ribosomal RNA. So it's basically this factory, basically, in the middle of the nucleolus, in the middle of the nucleus, that's producing ribosomal RNAs and ribosomes, and they will go to the rough ER, actually. So all of this will be transported out of the nucleus through the nuclear pores to the rough ER, and those ribosomes will end up on the rough ER. But they're produced in the nucleolus. Like that's its major function. And that's shown here as the site of assembly of ribosomal subunits. And if you see a cell with a prominent nucleolus, so this is like one cell here. This is the nucleus. This is the nucleolus of the cell. It means if it's got a strongly visible nucleolus that is producing a lot of ribosomes. That's what it means. And here we have some other. This is probably a neuron surrounded by some satellite cells. You can see that even they have their own nucleoli. So this is like one cell, nucleus, nucleolus, another cell, smaller cell.
Professor?
Yeah.
Is there a light up there that we can turn down?
Is this one blackboard?
Yeah. Yeah. Let's see.
Go, we got 5 days 24.
Where's the...
Sorry?
Where's the light switch?
The room. Maybe it's right there on the under that under the pink thing. Right, is that it? Or is that for the projector? That yeah there.
Yeah, so you found it?
Where?
Oh, I was pressing it, but nothing was happening. I mean, I guess I pressed it wrong. Okay, so.
That's a lot.
That's the nucleolus. The nucleolus is centrally located. It's going to be this darker region. As I mentioned, you also within the nucleus, you're going to have two types of chromatin, and the heterochromatin, which is the condensed, transcriptionally inactive DNA, will be around the periphery of the nucleus, sort of off to the side, near the nuclear membrane. Whereas the euchromatin, which is more opened up and transcriptionally active, will be lighter. It will be a lighter appearance. Like the chromatin is opened up. Like I said, you're going to see both of those all the time. You know, in pretty much any nucleus, you'll see some chromatin, some heterochromatin, some euchromatin. And basically, if there's like a lot of chromatin, a lot lot of chromatin. It means it's transcribing a lot of genes. If there's a lot of heterochromatin, there's less transcription. Okay. So that's sort of the basics of heterochromatin. What is this chromatin that I'm talking about? It's basically DNA, and that DNA is associated with proteins. So that's what chromatin means, like DNA and proteins. And those proteins, for the most part, are referred to as histones. So you're probably familiar with the idea of wrapping the DNA around proteins called histones. And but there's some other proteins too that contribute to chromatin. Various proteins known as nuclear matrix. Also, lamins that I'll talk about contribute to chromatin in some areas. But the majority of chromatin, in terms of the protein component, is histones. And they're basically groups of proteins around which the DNA is wrapped. And just one unit of histones with DNA wrapped around is called a nucleosome. So that's like the basic unit of chromatin, the nucleosome, which is basically DNA and histones. And then there's like various foldings that occur after that. So you have like core particles, histones, wrapped around to form this so-called second order folding. And that may attach to some of those other proteins I mentioned, nuclear matrix proteins, that's folded again. And that's called the third order folding. Then eventually the whole thing is packaged even further into what we know as chromosomes. So it's several steps of folding at an increasing scale until you get to the visible, or you know, at least with the microscope, visible chromosome structure. And it's important to realize that you know, only a small fraction of that chromatin is actually coding for genes. So about 20,000 human genes. And that you may hear 21,000, 19,000. It depends on the exact definition of a gene. But typically, a human cell will have 20,000 genes approximately. But only 1% of that is actually, only 1% of the entire DNA in a cell is actually genes that are coding for proteins. So what's the rest of it? It's actually very repetitive sequences. So about 3% of it is called satellite DNA, which is sequences of about 15 to 500 base pairs, repeated thousands of times. So just repeated over and over. And there's also an even larger component, about 45, even more percent, which is also repetitive DNA, moderately repeated sequences, repeated thousands of times, and these are actually transposons. And these are so called because they can move around, actually. So, some viruses can actually integrate into DNA. And when that's happened, like in the distant past, like human beings have picked up like ancient viral sequences, and they basically become fixed in the DNA. And these are known as transposons. Like we still have them. And it turns out that they're a very large percentage of the DNA. You can look up the term like junk DNA, and there's like a lot of research going into this to try to understand what it actually is. And some people believe it's very important. It's for regulating other genes, regulating gene expression. There's also certain logical arguments that it doesn't really do anything. Like you'll hear both views. So you can, I'm not going to go into it today, but you can look that up if you like. So how is that actually, we know that the chromatin, the DNA is basically wrapped around histones and then folded. And then we eventually end up with a chromosome. Like, what are the components of a chromosome? You basically have like certain landmarks in a chromosome. You have two arms. On all the chromosomes, you basically have two arms, the so-called P arm, which is the shorter arm. The Q arm is the longer one. And they're joined by a structure called the centromere. Then either end, you have caps called telomeres that protect the ends of the chromosomes. And during cell division, that entire chromosome will be copied through DNA duplication, through DNA polymerase. That's also known as the S phase or synthesis phase of mitosis. So you copy the whole thing, and you end up with two so-called chromatids. And they will be separated during mitosis, during the actual M phase, as it's called, of cell division, called mitosis, to form two entirely new chromosomes that will form two new daughter cells. So, and we'll talk a little bit more about mitosis in a moment. Before we do, just to give you an overview of what chromosomes look like in a human cell, you basically have 46. Typically, which will be 46XX or 46XY. And you can actually label them with different colors. You can use dyes to label the chromosomes. So here we have like chromosome 1 labeled in yellow, chromosome 2 labeled in red, 3 in blue, and so on. And there's software that can be used to visualize those. Like the software can actually plot those out for you, and this is known as a karyotype. It's important for diagnosis of disease, including things like cancer. So in cancer, you can often get very abnormal chromosome numbers, things like chromosome duplications, breakages, and so on. So, you know, if this was a cancer cell, it could look very different to this. Like you could have 3 copies of chromosome 12, for example, or 4 copies of chromosome 7. So this in situ hybridization, this labeling is used commonly to diagnose various conditions. A finer way to do it is a so-called karyotype analysis, or banding, which gives you like finer detail. So sometimes you may have, say, a deletion here on chromosome 1, or like something called an inversion, where a part breaks off and turns upside down and then reattaches. Like you're not gonna see that necessarily with this sort of in situ hybridization. So you can stain the chromosomes with dyes that label various sections more clearly. And this is known as banding. And if you know, some of you may have done it. You basically just drop the cells from like about a foot, and it sort of splashes and spreads out the chromosomes on the slide, and you can actually see them. And it enables you to see like a finer detail of banding patterns and possible chromosome breakages and so on. Yeah.
Our plan is anaphase instead of
metaphase. Oh yeah. So again, I'll send you the. You can actually do it with anaphase, but metaphase is better. Metaphase is good.
So we can just cross it and include metaphase, right?
Sorry.
We can just cross it and include metaphase.
Yeah, you can even correct it. Yeah, metaphase is better. So. And even in interphase, like not during cell division, you can actually visualize the chromosomes in the same way. You can label them with dyes, and you find that they actually localize to specific regions in the cell. Even not during metaphase, you can actually see them, like chromosome 7 is close to the membrane, chromosome 8 is more central and kind of points inwards towards the interior. And there's some research into this, like to try to understand like why chromosomes occupy certain regions. And again, you can use software to help you visualize that. So this is like one cell with a different chromosomes labeled, and the software will sort of give a precise location for the chromatin of each of those chromosomes. So that's the chromosomes. I mentioned cell division, mitosis. Like what is actually going on there? There's basically two things that can happen. The cell can be in a resting phase. This is known as G naught or G0. Basically, the cell is not going through mitosis. So this larger circle represents mitosis. G0 is basically a resting phase. Like the cell is not, it may go slightly forward, but it always gets blocked. It gets blocked at something called the restriction point. And that block prevents the cell from going into S phase. So the S phase is where you copy the DNA, you synthesize new DNA. The synthesis phase.
So during that phase from G0 to G1, the cell is not undergoing any
cellular. Right. Yeah. There's something called a restriction point. And it can't go further. And I'll explain why that is in the next slide. But you have to get through this to go through into mitosis, to go into the S phase, and then G2, GAP2, and then you get mitosis at the end in two new cells formed through cytokinesis. So this restriction point is like a major regulator of cell division. What is actually going on there? You basically have a protein called RB, which is blocking the cell cycle at the restriction point. RB is also known as retinoblastoma protein. You might have heard of it before. And it basically prevents the cell from going into S phase at this restriction point. Normally, RB is unphosphorylated in cells that are in a resting state. It's unphosphorylated, and the unphosphorylated form is actually the active form. So it's active at blocking the restriction point. For the cell to go forward, it has to be, the RB has to be phosphorylated. So it's unphosphorylated is the active form. Becomes phosphorylated by a complex of proteins called CDK4 and cyclin D. So these two will phosphorylate the RB. They add a phosphate group to the RB, and that makes it inactive. So did you get that? Does that make sense so far?
You said the phosphorylated RB protein makes it inactive?
Yes, exactly.
And then the unphosphorylated prevents the expression of the cell?
Yeah, the unphosphorylated form is the active form of RB. Yeah. And phosphorylation is funny, some proteins, their phosphorylated form is active. You may have seen that before, which can be confusing, why is it, how can it happen both ways? But it really, it depends on the actual protein that you're dealing with. But like with RB, the unphosphorylated form is the active form blocking the cell at the restriction point. Then it has to be phosphorylated to make it inactive. And it's phosphorylated by this complex of protein CDK4 and cyclin D. These two work together, they add the phosphate to RB and then it becomes inactive. And then the restriction point is no longer in effect and the cell goes through into S phase, duplicates the DNA, there's a second gap, and then mitosis occurs. So it's like a major point of controlling cell division. And this is important for things like cancer, like the RB, if the RB gene is mutated, it can actually create like a permanently inactive form. And like the cells just keep dividing and dividing, which is like a hallmark of cancer. Like basically the restriction point is gone. So there's like no longer any control there. And that can also be caused like by abnormalities in CDK4 and cyclin D2. So there's various ways that this could go wrong. But it basically leads to an uncontrolled cell division. And I might have updated this to 20. So how many do you have on your slide, Tracy? You have 20? Sorry?
11.
Okay, so yeah, there's actually been, there's more being discovered all the time. So at this point, this is like the most up to date. You have 20 human CDK. But only four are critical for regulating the cell cycle. And those are 1, 2, 4, and 6, like you'd want to memorize that. And all four of those can inhibit RB. They can all phosphorylate RB and render it inactive and therefore block DNA synthesis. And there's also a second activity of CDK2 in that it phosphorylates lamins, which are proteins in the nucleus, and it breaks down the nuclear envelope during mitosis. So that's like an additional function of CDK2 sites interacting with RB. And for all of these, you also need the cyclin. So, the CDKs always cooperate with the cyclin as a cofactor to phosphorylate the RB. And there's actually 29 human cyclins, according to most up-to-date count. So that's how the cell cycle is controlled. Let's talk about more detail of the actual phases of the cell cycle as a cell divides, which is known as mitosis. So early on, so when a cell is resting, it's called interphase. As you're going into cell division, you go through several steps before you actually reach the end point, the actual creation of two new cells. And there's basically five steps to that: prophase, prometaphase, metaphase, anaphase, and telophase. In prophase, what's going on is you're getting like a condensation of that chromatin. So in a resting state, the state is the cell, is sort of not going through cell division. It will be, some of the chromatin might be opened up, but as you go into prophase, all of the chromatin will condense. So prophase is characterized by a large scale of chromatin condensation. And as you go into prometaphase, the actual nuclear envelope, nuclear membrane break down. So this is like one cell here. This is the nucleus. These are the forming chromosomes. And as you see, as you go from prometaphase into metaphase, that nuclear membrane disappears. But as you go into metaphase, you basically don't have a nucleus as such by that point. You've just got chromosomes lined up down the middle of the cell. And they attach to something called the spindle or mitotic spindle, which is made of those microtubules we talked about on Monday. So those microtubules form this specialized structure known as the mitotic spindle, and they attach to the chromosome. And then during anaphase, those chromosomes are pulled apart. Literally in opposite directions. And at telophase, you have a formation of a new nuclear membrane and a new cell membrane. So like the nucleus becomes enclosed again, and the cell forms a new membrane between, internally to create two new cells. Those are like the five major steps of mitosis. Let's talk about each one in more detail. In prophase, as I said, like all the chromosomes become condensed. So for example, chromosome 22 shrinks in length from 1.5 centimeters to about 2 micrometers. So almost a 10,000-fold decrease in length. You also have duplication of the centrioles, which are kind of like the two anchors on either side for the microtubules. And the microtubules are assembled and formed. So that all happens in prophase. And then I don't really go into the details of prometaphase. It's really sort of the bridge between prophase and metaphase. But by the time you get to metaphase, that nuclear envelope is gone, as I said. So you don't really have a nucleus by the time you get into metaphase. And that allows the microtubules to attach to the kinetochore, which is like a specialized part of the centromere on the chromosome, where you can it basically allows the microtubules to kind of hook onto the centromere at the specialized location called the kinetochore. We'll talk about that in a moment. So it's kind of like a molecular hook or glue, if you will, that allows the microtubules to bind into the chromosomes. It's known as the kinetochore. And you also have a lining up of the chromosomes down in the middle of the cell, on either side of the microtubules. And you also have an important protein that you want to memorize called cohesin. So that is initially used to allow chromosomes to line up. So during metaphase, the chromosomes line up down the middle of the cell. And cohesin is like the protein that facilitates the lining up of the chromosomes down the middle. But it doesn't stay there indefinitely. Most of it is removed. Like once they've lined up, once that alignment has occurred, it's removed and you just have like one, it only remains basically at the kinetochore. During the alignment, it's down the entire length chromosome. You just have this remaining cohesin, like right at the kinetochore where the microtubules are attaching to the chromosome. So you have this sort of arrangement. You have the chromatins here. Yet these are the centromeres. Most of the cohesin is removed, but you just have this remaining part here with the microtubules coming in and attaching. So it's quite a lot going on here at the centromere, the kinetochore. And that's how that looks like on an electron microscope. You can actually see it. So you have the chromosomes lined up down the middle. These are the microtubules of the spindle. These are the centrioles. And you can actually see it visually on the on on the EM image, but the kind of microtubules are attaching right here at the kinetic core, which is basically at the same point as the centromere in the middle of the chromatin. And there's like a lot of proteins that go into forming this kinetic core where the microtubule attaches to the chromatin. If you can find a lot of figures showing this, and in some of them there's like dozens of proteins. But this is like the clearest one that I've found so far. Basically what it shows is the microtubule over here, and this, you have this major protein here known as DAN1 that is basically on the microtubule side, and that is like critical for enabling the microtubule to bind to the chromatin, and this is the chromatin side over here. So on one side we have the microtubule, the other side we have the chromatin. And DAN1 was, you know, one of the, if not the first protein identified that was necessary for the formation of the kinetochore on the microtubule side. The protein that's most important on the other side is known as CAMP protein. And they also contribute to forming this molecular hook between the microtubule and the chromatin. And this whole thing is known as the kinetochore. But the only proteins I'd ask you to remember are this DAN1 on the microtubule side and CNP on the chromatin side. And there's various other accessory proteins that are indicated here. Don't worry about what they are. If you pull up a figure, you know, other figures, you may see it even more complexly represented than this. But yeah, those two on either side are like critical for formation of the kinetochore between the chromatin and the microtubule. Okay.
So do they play a role on activation, or they just part of the structure?
I don't think they're involved in activation, but that's an interesting question. There are actually some proteins involved in activation that I'll come to in a moment. Yep. So yeah, basically that allows the microtubule to literally pull on the chromatin on one side, and the microtubule on the other side will pull in the other direction. So what you have is basically what's known as anaphase, the separation of those chromatins, and that's carried about. That's initiated. That's you know, you were thinking along the right lines. That's by a protein known as anaphase promoting complex, or APC. And what that does is degrades the remaining cohesin that was holding the two centromeres together. Remember I was saying you have this remaining cohesin, most of it's removed, but the APC is what removes the anaphase promoting complex, is what removes that remaining piece of cohesin. Then that allows the microtubules to exert force on the chromatins. The APC also degrades those cyclins that were phosphorylating RB. It basically degrades those and sort of starts to shut down that inactivated RB. It's basically returning RB, the cyclins, and thereby RB to the inactive state. RB would be it returns it to the active state, So it returns it to the state where it can block cell division. Do you have this one in your, is this updating? No, okay. So I mean, this is basically the same idea, but what I wanted to show here is that, we're all familiar with the idea of microtubules pulling. So, you have like a separation literally pulling movement, but there's also, interestingly enough, there's also a cushion, so that the microtubules that attach in the very middle, outside of the kinetochore. So we have like kinetochore, we have kinetochore microtubules that are pulling separating chromatids. There's also so-called polar microtubules that overlap outside of the kinetochores. And they interestingly enough, push on each other. And that also generates force in either direction, you know, in opposite directions. So it's interesting that the cell does it that way. So you have both a pulling at the kinetochore and a pushing apart at these polar microtubules. And the whole thing facilitates the separation of the chromatin. So kinetochore microtubules are in the purple and polar microtubules are in the green. And they both basically work together to generate forces to separate the two. So that's basically mitosis. The other cell type of cell division you've heard of is meiosis. And there's a couple of things that are different about meiosis, important things that are different from mitosis. And those are crossing over and formation of haploid cells. So normally you have 23 paternal and 23 maternal chromosomes in a cell. And during mitosis, those would be copied identically into the two daughter cells. So you have, there's no changes occurring, there's no switching of the DNA and so on. So you have like the exact same structure of the chromosomes maintained during mitosis. In meiosis, you actually have exchange. You have switching between the paternal and maternal chromosomes. So during metaphase, meiosis, you have the complementary. So when the chromosomes line up during mitosis, it doesn't really matter how exactly they're arranged, as long as they're down the middle of the cell, and then the microtubules pull them apart. During meiosis, you actually have for example, paternal chromosome 1 will line up with maternal chromosome 1. Paternal chromosome 2 will line up with maternal chromosome 2, and so on. So every single chromosome will pair to its complement. And they actually then exchange DNA between the two. So it creates like a whole new sequence of the DNA in the daughter nuclei. And that happens during meiosis one. So there's two steps to meiosis, two cell divisions. The crossing over occurs in meiosis one. And then the meiosis two, you generate haploid cells. What that means is you're gonna end up with 23 chromosomes only in the spermatozoa, and 23 chromosomes in the oocytes, in the ovaries. So the reason you need to do that is, when fertilization occurs, you're bringing those 23 together again to make a new set of 46. So both types of gametes only have the 23 chromosomes. Those are known as haploid cells. And so those two things are really essential for meiosis. During meiosis, when you have that pairing of the paternal and maternal, very precisely, that doesn't happen in mitosis, there's specialized proteins that pair them together. So it's not I think cohesin is involved to some extent, but the major one is known as synaptoenamel complex protein, SCP1. And this is basically a protein that binds the paternal and maternal chromosomes on either side. So there's different stages of meiosis one, known as leptotenes, like that don't, you know, don't worry about those, you don't need to memorize those. Like the basic idea here is that this SCP1 is necessary for complementary binding of the maternal and maternal chromosomes to each other. So you want to memorize that, like that's an important protein. And the other one is Rad51. And that is that. So the SCP1 is binding them together. And the Rad51 is what is actually doing the cutting and splicing of the DNA between the two complementary chromosomes. So that crossing over is carried out by Rad51. It's a so-called recombinase protein. Interestingly enough, that's found in lymphoid organs. So you know, if you need to generate new antibodies against a pathogen, that Rad51 is used just like it is in meiosis. It's used to cut and splice DNA to generate new antibodies. And you can even see the SCP1 between chromatids. So here we have, this would be like, say for example, maternal chromosome 1, part of chromosome 1. This is the paternal. And you can actually visualize with a high magnification electron microscope, you can see the SCP1 holding the two chromatids together. And then Rad51 will come in and cut and splice and form that crossing over between the two. So that's what's shown here. So those two together are critical. Also, there's a couple of things that, yeah.
What was the image in the middle shown?
That's just, sort of intermediate between this, nothing really is different. I mean, it's just showing that more SCP1 is being formed here. So this is, in other words, like here we have this lower part has SCP1, and then you see more SCP1 added and it joins up the whole thing. Basically, you see that? Okay. And then Rad51 will then come in and do the cutting and splicing. Okay. So we talked about mitosis and meiosis. What's actually controlling that? Like what's regulating mitosis and meiosis? So, but what I mean by that is, in some cells, you actually need a switch from mitosis to meiosis. And I don't mean all cells. I'm talking about principally cells called spermatogonia. So the spermatogonia are stem cells in the testes that will actually make the spermatozoa, but they're usually in a mitotic state. So they're just resting, they're kind of maintaining like a stem cell pool, and they're undergoing mitosis, but sometimes they're gonna go into meiosis to generate spermatozoa. So what is actually regulating that? This has been studied in mice, and it turns out that retinoic acid is very important for regulating that. So these cells would be in, so this is like mitosis here. So you just have an exact copy of the chromosomes over here after the cell is divided. To have it go into meiosis, you need retinoic acid. You also need a special protein called DAZL. It's known as needed in azoospermia light. And that basically pushes the cell into meiosis, and then it'll go through those two steps, the crossing over and generating the haploid gametes. The reason it's called DAZL, or Dillian azoospermia-like, is that there were mutations found in some mice where they basically had a very difficult time getting cells into meiosis. So these mice were, you know, had a fertility issue in terms of generating spermatozoa. That's how the DAZL was discovered. Like it wasn't, this whole switch wasn't working properly. So, you know, it's normally, when you refer to this, it's mostly referring to the spermatogonia, which are the stem cells in testes. But interestingly enough, like you can, I've actually seen some studies where they've been able to sort of initiate like a meiosis-like state, even in somatic cells, like that don't, you know, skin cells and whatnot, that don't normally do that. Like if you treat them with retinoic acid, DAZL, and some other proteins, you can sort of get them to go into meiosis or similar to meiosis, which is interesting. Like, you know, it's, I find it surprising that that's even possible. That's another story. So that's about it for mitosis and meiosis. I talked about earlier about you know, as I said, we may go a little over time with the nucleus and we should be under time with the mitochondria. Gene transcription, I mentioned earlier, like nuclei have different shapes, different sizes, different heterochromatin, euchromatin arrangements. Why is that? It's basically because cells are expressing different sets of genes. So like a muscle cell will express its own set. Neural cells have their own set of genes. And that's you know, basically giving that different appearance to the nucleus. And if cells are like a neuron, they express even more, you know, more than most cells. So you see a lot of euchromatin actually in the large nucleus and a lot of euchromatin in the nucleus. How is that actually being regulated? In other words, why do some nuclei activate specific genes and other nuclei activate other genes? It's basically regulated by transcription factors that you may have heard of. So say this is a typical gene. It's the way it's going to be transcribed is you have RNA polymerase come in and turn and transcribe that DNA into RNA. But that can be turned up or down. You know, that can be regulated. The degree to what that happens, to the degree to which that happens, can be regulated by transcription factors. So they kind of bind upstream the DNA, and there's a certain sequence known as the tapabox that sort of facilitates binding of transcription factors. And they basically, what the transcription factors do essentially is increase the activity of RNA polymerase. So you basically, in the absence of these transcription factors, like RNA polymerase activity is very minimal, if active at all. So the transcription factors essentially boost up the transcription of the RNA polymerase. You also have so-called enhancers that can work even further upstream. So we have the same thing here, RNA polymerase and transcription factors. And we follow the DNA back upstream, and you find so-called regulator sequences or enhancer sequences, where you can have even additional transcription factors, also known as enhancers, where the DNA folds over, and this will enhance the activity of RNA polymerase even further. So it can boost the gene transcription even higher than it was just from the transcription factors alone. And there's like over 2,000 of these known now, so they're like a very important control of gene transcription. A good example would be OX4 and SOX2. These are like transcription factors that are found in very early embryonic cells. So this is a gene. They're regulating expression of the gene called NANO. So NANO is also a gene that's only expressed in very early undifferentiated cells during embryogenesis. This is the RNA polymerase. So we have, you have some transcription factors here finding and increasing the activity of RNA polymerase, increasing transcription of NAD. But you also need these to get like high level expression, you also need these enhancers, enhancing regulating sequences. So OX4, SOX2, and some others kind of bind upstream and the DNA folds over and activates this complex, including RNA polymerase even more, and that boosts up the activity of the transcription of NAD. So that's like a general principle of gene regulation, gene transcription regulation. And interestingly enough, you can actually, you can put some of these factors into cells. So say you take a fibroblast and you put in or OX4, SOX2, you put in some of these transcription factors, it will actually reprogram it. You know, it will change the transcription of the cell and make it so-called pluripotent. And then you could use that pluripotent cell to generate other cells, like you could make beta cells, and you know, for pancreas, say someone has diabetes, they need new pancreatic beta cells, you could reprogram their fibroblasts with these transcription factors and then differentiate them into other cells, so like beta cells or neurons, hepatocytes in the liver. This is still, you know, this is not like a, you know, this is not a mature technology yet, but the idea is, there's a lot of work going into this, like that you could reprogram cells to give patients for different things, like new cells, essentially, through the reprogramming. Another interesting aspect of gene regulation is X chromosome inactivation. So in a female cell, you have two X chromosomes, but one of them is inactivated and condensed. And so it shows up with like a special marker called ZIST, ZXIST. You can actually label it in a cell, like there's specific proteins on that inactivated X that allow you to visualize it. And it's usually like off to the side of the nucleus. Becomes inactivated and onto the site. And that process is random, actually. So it occurs during early development, early embryogenesis. But it's not the same X chromosome in every cell of that developing embryo, which has some interesting implications that I don't have time to go into now, but we'll talk about it more in the epigenetics lecture. Which will come up later. But yeah, that X chromosome activation has like some very interesting features, like in terms of lifespan and things like that. Difference in the rate of aging between men and women and so on. So women live longer typically than men. It's thought this could be involved. But again, we'll come back to it later. But basically you have the X chromosome becomes attached to the nucleolus and sort of, and you can see it in, you can actually see it in other cells even with a light microscope. It's called a bar body, and it will be attached to the nucleolus in the nucleus, sometimes referred to as sex chromatin. You can see it in some leukocytes also. And then lastly, the last thing I want to talk about in the talk is lamins that I've mentioned before. So here, you know, you may remember from the cytoskeleton lecture that there's like a special intermediate filament in the nucleus. It's known as lamins. So this is like one nucleus. Here we have like the extracellular, you know, the cytoplasmic cytoskeletal filaments. The lamin here is shown in where it's green. So it's right against the membrane. So this blue is the heterochromatin, this is euchromatin. Lamins tend to be localized very close to the nuclear membrane. It's not entirely, so you may see it coming interiorly sometimes as well. Like this is a bit exaggerated, it's not always so clear cut, but it's basically lining the, for the most part, lining the inner nuclear membrane. That, you know, you can also think of it as laminating the inner nuclear membrane. That's where the name came from. It laminates that inner nuclear membrane. And there are basically a variety of intermediate filament. There's various subtypes, different genes can create different forms. And they interact with DNA. It's not just, the point I want to make here is it's not just sitting there. So it does actually interact with DNA, interacts with RB, regulates a lot of other proteins. You can even see it. So here we have the lamin. It's actually shown here interacting with nuclear pores. So it's what you can also sort of regulate the import and export. Here we see the actual nuclear membrane of the nucleus. This is a nuclear core. And the lamin here is shown in light blue, and you can see it's lining the inner nuclear membrane, but it's also, there are fragments of it coming in and interacting with the retinoblastoma, which as we know is important for the cell cycle. Some DNA can be associated with lamins. There's also another protein called nuclear actin that can associate with lamins. So, the point being that it's actually involved with a lot of things, and you know there's a lot of research going on trying to understand that. The most obvious manifestation of pathology associated with lamin is progeria, which is accelerated aging. So normally in a human nucleus, you're going to have the lamin very well organized around just inside the nuclear membrane. You know, and as I say, there may be some minor components inside the nucleus as well. But it, like a normal nucleus is going to have a very smooth shape. If that lamin is mutated, it gives a very irregular shape to the nucleus. And that basically, ultimately, to cut a long story short, will really interfere with cell division. So progeria, You know, as I understand it, you know, I believe it's a profound loss of cell division, and it basically leads to aging. You can see the same thing in mice. So, you know, if you see the same mutation in mice, it can lead to loss of bone tissue, loss of skin tissue, and so on. You know, it's a pretty serious pathology. And the point is, it's not something that just kind of looks like aging. You can make a strong case that it actually is aging at the cellular level. And there's like various therapies there's various attempts to create therapies for it. The mutated form of lamin A becomes farnesylated, so there's like a farnesyl group that's added to the lamin A. And normally that farnesyl group is removed. Like it's added temporarily. I'm talking about a normal lamin. They have a farnesyl group. And then before it's incorporated into the membrane, that farnesyl group is removed. But with the mutated lamin A in progeria, like that farnesyl group cannot be removed. So that's part of the reason that the nucleus becomes distorted, is this inability to remove the farnesyl group. So the idea of one attempted therapy is to block the farnesylation in the first place. Like don't have it farnesylated at all, so you don't have to remove it, and you can get like a normal incorporation of the lamin into the membrane, basically rendering. And there's been some trials, clinical trials of the NIH, but it doesn't have a dramatic effect. I would say it works to a certain extent, like the kids with progeria growing about a year, living about a year or two longer, but it's not like a dramatic extension of their life. So there needs to be better therapies. This is just like one example. And then lastly, the nuclear pores. So as I said, we've gone from the interior outwards, we've arrived at the nuclear pores. These are basically channels, like on the surface of the nucleus. So this is like one nucleus, all these are nuclear pores. And they're basically allowing import and export of various molecules between the nucleus and the cytoplasm. This is one seen in cross-section, very highly magnified. You can see some better chromatin on the side. Here we actually have it's kind of like an annulus. It's sort of a circular arrangement of the proteins with a channel down the middle. And if you look, so this is a transmission EM. If you do a scanning, you see like hundreds to thousands, could be up to 3,000 or 4,000 of these pores. And the basic structure is an eight protein clusters. So if you magnify them enough with an EM, you can actually see these eight clusters of proteins surrounding the central core. And the proteins that make that structure are called nuclear porins. And it's like actually a surprisingly complex structure. There's like hundreds of proteins that make up that one nuclear pore. Like it's really quite complex for what it's actually doing. It's so surprising. And basically what they do is that the pores are in the membrane. And here we have the nuclear side over here. This is the cytoplasm, and it basically exports things like the ribosomes from the nucleolus to the ER, will be coming out through the nuclear pores. And you can also have things imported sometimes. So sometimes some proteins may be imported to actually regulate gene transcription. That can also occur. That's it. So, you want to take a 5-minute break and then try to get through mitochondria? Okay. Yeah, no problem. I'll get them to you. How was your day before this? Like, what have you had so far? Oh, wow. You're already in that section.
Yeah. Pretty cool.
Yeah, my Dr. Bernard and Dr. Bernard and Dr. Roman.
Yeah.
I didn't realize it started that.
Yeah, it's not a heavy one. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah, I'll send it. I'll send it. So, that's where the ATP is being made. Like that's where it's sort of necessary to. So it's essential to have that intermembrane space for the generation of ATP. And I'll talk about that. This is just an electron microscope image of several mitochondria. So this is one. This is another one. We see the double membrane, outer membrane, inner membrane, intermembrane space. We see the infoldings of the inner membrane, the cristae. We see the mitochondrial matrix, and we also see a granule here, which is where the calcium is stored. So they're called matrix granules, basically, which are a major site for calcium storage. And this is like a larger magnification of a single mitochondria. You can see the infolding of the inner membrane better here. So you see the outer, and then the inner folds in to form this crystal. And we also see the matrix in a bit more detail with ribosomes. And the ATP production actually, as I mentioned, occurs here. There's some interesting, before we get to that, there's some interesting sort of histological or visual features of astrocyte, of mitochondria in different cells. So astrocytes, for example, have so-called prismatic crystal, which are more triangular. So we're looking at this in cross-section, and the actual cristae are triangular, and it's thought that this shape actually allows a denser packing. Allows like a close packing of the cristae compared to having them sort of have a tubular shape. I'm not entirely convinced that that's the reason. Like, it seems, a little dubious, but that's like the classic textbook definition that the prismatic cristae allow closer packing and thereby like even greater ATP production than you would have normally. Another aspect of mitochondria is that they can divide and they can fuse and divide just like cells can. So even within the cell can split mitochondria to form two new ones. So say you have a single mitochondria here, it starts to form a new membrane down the middle and will actually produce two new mitochondria. So it actually is capable of division. And interestingly enough, that can go in reverse as well. So say the cell doesn't need so much ATP anymore, it will actually fuse its mitochondria and decrease the overall number of the cell. And this can be go up and down like the number of mitochondria, depending on how much ATP is needed. They're also moved around on microtubules, which we've talked about before. So here we actually see some microtubules in the longitudinal section, some here. And we can actually see several mitochondria being transported along the microtubule. So it's sort of interesting how you can literally visualize that with a electron microscope. another sort of fact about them is that they say you need to localize mitochondria to a specific location within the cell. You use the microtubules to do that in the motor proteins. And why would you want to do that? So it could be, for example, that you have, say, in a synapse. So this is like part of the synapse. There's a lot of ion transport that occurs in the synapse. So this is, you need to pump ions out. There's also neurotransmitters being released and reabsorbed and so on. So in other words, like a lot of energy is needed at this location. So you'll often see close to a synapse that the cell has transported its mitochondria adjacent to the synapse to provide locally needed ATP. So this is a very, very common phenomenon. So let's actually get into the ATP generation. How is that actually happening? So this is a single mitochondria. This is the outer membrane. Over here, this is the inner membrane, so it's the double membrane, this is the intermembrane space. These are a couple of cristae illustrated here. And as I said, the ATP production occurs in the intermembrane space. So what you have is nutrients coming in initially, say pyruvate or fatty acids, and they go through the citric acid cycle. You might get more of that in the biochemistry course. And that basically produces NADH. So that's kind of the starting point, you could say, for the generation of the ATP. So the NADH is made by the citric acid cycle. You then have that converted to NAD plus, and that releases an electron. And that electron then goes through a process called the electron transport chain. So it's transported through proteins in the inner membrane. And as it does that, it pulls through electrical charge, it pulls hydrogen ions into the intermembrane space. And the hydrogen ions build up there. They're also known as protons. They basically build up there. And when the cell needs ATP, those protons will flow back into the interior of the mitochondria through a protein called ATP synthase. And it's kind of a curious protein in that it actually has a rotational component to it. So as the hydrogen ions flow back, it causes part of the ATP synthase to rotate, and that it allows a phosphate to be added to ADP to create ATP. And then that ATP is exported out of the mitochondria to wherever it may be needed. And then the hydrogen ion is back inside, and that can be recycled again, pulled back out by the electron. So that's like the basic idea. Like, there's several proteins that are involved in that transport chain. So here we see the electron coming in, it pulls the hydrogen ion out. And each step, you know, I've got three shown here, three protein complexes, three steps. Occasionally you might see four. I don't know if have you started with Dr. Burns yet? Maybe that's later in the year.
You haven't started.
Yeah. So I think he says sometimes it's four, and it depends on what you include. But basically, you have this electron pulling the hydrogen ion. Each step, there's a proton accumulates, and then it flows back through ATP synthase. And the three important protein complexes. So this is the flow of the electron this way. You see the arrow, and each one pulls a hydrogen ion. You want to remember these three, NADH dehydrogenase is the first one, cytochrome B-C1 complex is the second, cytochrome oxidase is the third. And each of these complexes is capable of pulling a hydrogen ion facilitated by the electron into the intermembrane space. And one electron will pass through each of those three, and each time will add a hydrogen ion to the intermembrane space. And as I mentioned, that will flow back. So here we have the intermembrane space up here. This is the inner mitochondrial membrane. The hydrogen ion flows back. As it does so, it causes this rotational component to rotate, and that will add a phosphate to ADP to make ATP. And then that will be exported out, actually, in the mitochondria to where it is needed. So that's like the essentials of ATP. I won't go too much into it.
I know
those three complexes. There's also other aspects of the, the story doesn't end there. It's like, so you need to get the ATP out of the mitochondria. So that's done through a protein called the ATP transporter. And it basically exports the ATP out through a protein called VDAC. And nutrients also enter through that same protein, this VDAC voltage dependent anion channel. It's basically necessary for both import of nutrients and export of ATP. So you can add that on to the title of the slide. I have it here as well. But like, in other words, this VDAC is a very important protein because you you get the ATP produced, but you actually need to get it out. You have this mitochondria, you have the ATP transporter and VDAC necessary for getting the ATP out of the mitochondria to where it's needed. That it's also needed for import of nutrients initially, such as pyruvate go in through VDAC. And you basically have the mitochondria will essentially line up this ATP transporter close to VDAC, so it will try to co-localize them to facilitate the exit of the ATP. So these two will be aligned, if possible. And the way that occurs is, so we have the VDAC up here. This is the ATP transporter, and there's like a kind of a homing signal, if you will, called cardiolipin. And both the VDAC and the ATP transporter are attracted to this cardiolipin. The VDAC is on the outer membrane, so this is the outer membrane. This upper one, the lower one is the inner membrane. The cardiolipin is on the inner membrane, but they are both molecularly attracted to this cardiolipin. So that is what facilitates the alignment, basically, of this so-called ATP transporter in the VDAC. So it basically forms almost like a continuous channel that allows the ATP to exit, so in one step. It's almost like a continuous channel. And cardiolipin is necessary there for sort of the alignment to occur. It's on the inner membrane, but the VDAC will also line up with the cardiolipin as it will be transported. So that's like import of nutrients and export of ATP. There's actually other things that the mitochondria needs to import and export, like the various proteins need to be imported. Some proteins need to be exported. And this is done through different proteins, not through the ATP transporter, but through something called TON and TIN, TON, transport outer membrane and transport inner membrane proteins. And it's a similar idea to this VDAC and ATP transporter. So you have like the outer membrane here. This is the inner membrane. And on the outer membrane, you have this TOM, in this particular case, TOM40. That's like the outer membrane transporter. And then you have a TIM44, is the inner membrane transporter. And they also line up. So say you need to get a protein into a cell, into the mitochondria. It will be tagged with something called a matrix targeting sequence. So there's like a certain sequence of amino acids will be added to this protein that allows it to be recognized by a receptor on the surface of the outer membrane. It's not exactly the same as the TOM, but it's basically a receptor that will hand over, it will recognize the sequence, this matrix targeting sequence, it will bind to it, and it will hand it over to the TOM protein. So you see the receptor is in green. It binds to the matrix targeting sequence and then it hands that protein over to TOM. And then TOM, then it passes through the channel in TOM and it passes to TIN. And then that will be imported into the matrix of the mitochondria. And this is, you see this not just in mitochondria, it can happen in nuclei too. Like you can tag proteins with different amino acid sequences, known as targeting sequences. So there's like a nuclear localization signal. There's the matrix targeting sequence of the mitochondria. There's various other things, Golgi localization signal. It basically allows the cell to move proteins where they are needed based on these targeting sequences. The ones that are used in the mitochondria occur through the TOM and TIM proteins, helped by the receptors that are associated. So the initial binding is to a receptor, then it passes it on to the TOM and TIM. Another aspect of mitochondria that's sort of kind of its own thing, it's not really connected to ATP at all, it's cholesterol metabolism. So, and by that I mean generation of steroid hormones. So you need the mitochondria for the first steps of that. And they are generated from cholesterol. So this is a one cell, actually. This is the mitochondria of the cell. And on the surface of the cell, there are receptors for cholesterol, like LDL, low-density lipoprotein receptor, HDL, high-density lipoprotein receptor. And they basically bind cholesterol and internalize it. They can both internalize it. LDL does it more through a sort of endosome lysosome type mechanism, whereas HDL is more direct. But the net result is you have cholesterols being imported into the cell, and then that cholesterol is transported into the mitochondria through a protein called STAR, which is steroidogenic acute regulatory protein. And it basically brings cholesterol into the mitochondria, and then that cholesterol will be converted into steroid hormones. The first one being pregnenolone, that is like the beginning of the whole generation of steroids. Early on you have things like DHEA, you may have heard of before, so it's like there's like several steps. You eventually end up being able to generate them all, like progesterone, estrogen, testosterone. They basically all originate from these steps. The beginning of the mitochondria where you have generation of pregnenolone. So that's like a whole other thing that mitochondria do that's not really directly connected to ATP. And cells that are, mitochondria that are generating a lot of steroid hormones tend to have so-called tubular cristae, which are cristae that are a little thicker than usual. So you'll see like these so-called tubular cristae, which means that they're sort of thicker than the cristae we saw like in the first few slides. And that's like a very characteristic feature of the steroid synthesizing cells. So the end, it's related to the enzymes and the enzymology of like cholesterol metabolism. Another thing they do, again, that's not related to ATP generation is calcium storage. So this is like pretty complex figure, and you don't need to memorize all of this. Like what I'm trying to illustrate is that just like the import of the cholesterol and the TIM TOM story, you also have calcium being imported into mitochondria, and that's done. You do want to memorize that one: mitochondrial calcium uniporter, also known as MCU, mitochondrial calcium uniporter. And that will basically import calcium into the mitochondria and will store it as needed in those granules that you saw earlier. Remember those matrix granules? They're basically containing calcium. And then that can be exported to the ER, endoplasmic reticulum, as needed. There's a lot of calcium metabolism in the ER. you don't need to memorize all of this. It's just the basic principle of exchange of calcium between the mitochondria and the rough ER, and storage in the mitochondria in the matrix granules, with import occurring through the calcium uniporter. Wow, we're at three already? You've got a lecture. All right, so just memorize that mitochondria with calcium uniporter, which is importing the calcium into the mitochondria, storing it in the matrix granules, and then exporting it to the ER as needed. And you basically see them as these dots in the interior of the matrix, the mitochondria. There may be like one large one or several smaller ones, and they're basically containing calcium. The other aspect that I mentioned earlier as well is mitochondria have their own DNA, RNA, and ribosomes. So you may have heard of mitochondrial DNA. It's basically entirely separate from the nuclear DNA. It's contained in the mitochondria. It's capable of transcription, translation, protein synthesis. And then those proteins can be exported, like I mentioned, to other parts of the cell. Quite often they're proteins that take part in the electron transport chain, but not exclusively. Like, they can actually be exported to other parts of the cell. And you basically got an entire transcription translation mechanism operating within the mitochondria. And there's like several differences between mitochondrial and nuclear DNA. There's fewer transfer RNAs than you would see like in the rest of the cell. There's slightly relaxed pairing rules between the bases. The genetic code is a little different from the nuclear code. But more interestingly, the mitochondrial genes evolve more rapidly than nuclear genes. So you can use that. You've ever done a DNA test, like through say 23andMe or something, that you'll get a mitochondrial group, and that can be used for genealogy. It can be used for constructing family trees and so on. And it basically occurs through something called cytoplasmic inheritance. So, in other words, you get all of your mitochondria from your mother, from the egg of your mother. So it's this so-called matrilineal inheritance of mitochondria DNA. There are actually some exceptions to that. So very surprisingly, as in the last couple of years, there have been some papers describing paternal inheritance of mitochondrial DNA. So apparently, on rare occasions, the sperm can actually bring in mitochondrial DNA into the egg, which doesn't normally happen. But some individuals actually have both maternal and paternal mitochondrial DNA. It's unusual, but it can happen. And so that's basically it for the DNA. Where did mitochondria actually originate from? The idea is that at some point in evolution, there was an absorption of a bacterium by an ancient eukaryotic cell that basically absorbed the bacterium into the cytoplasm. And that bacterium might have been like extremely efficient at generating ATP, and it basically boosted the metabolism of the eukaryote cell. Conversely, the eukaryote provided a safe environment for the mitochondria, so it it, you know, you have this symbiotic event, and you basically created a whole new organism that became the eukaryotes that, that we have today. So it was effectively a unique event evolutionary that, that led to the complex life, arguably, that we have today. What is your lecture? I'm getting increasingly anxious here.
Cell membranes.
Cell membranes. Is that a long one or
1 hour?
1 hour. Can you give me another 5 minutes or so? So the last thing I want to talk about is mitochondrial biogenesis. So what I mean by that is you need to, the cell needs to increase or decrease mitochondria and alter their metabolism according to the energy demands of the organism and the cells. So I already mentioned earlier, you can increase number, you can decrease number. What are the stimuli for that? You know, how can that be studied? It basically, you know, when cells are, you know, when ATP becomes depleted, cells will respond by metabolizing glycogen, generating more glucose, increasing glucose uptake, increasing mitochondrial number, activity, use more ATP. How does that actually, what's actually regulating that? The major sensor for fuel in the cell is known as AMPK, which stands for AMP activator protein kinase. And that's activated by an increase in the AMP to ATP ratio. So it's like a signal for low ATP. It can also be, the signal can also be generated by increased phosphocreatine. And AMPK basically senses that. And then that will alter the function of many other proteins and the transcription of genes within the mitochondria, within the cell itself. Downstream of AMPK, there's another important protein called NRF1 and NRF2. So they basically work together. And these are basically the next step after AMPK activation. NRF1 and NRF2 create they magnify the signal of the AMPK and then alter the activity of many other genes. So what you have is like a cascade of activity. So you get AMPK activation. You will, for example, increase the activity of GLUT4, glucose transport will be increased, increased nitric oxide synthase, blood flow, and so on. But also, conversely, decreased breakdown of fats and protein, decreased protein synthesis, so you don't want to be creating new molecules. You basically want to be metabolizing them. So, and this whole thing is regulated by AMPK, NRF1, and NRF2. And say you create like an artificial starvation state. So these rats, this is tissue sections of rats that were fed a creatine analog, basically, that simulates starvation. And you can see that when you look at the mitochondrial number, you basically get a dramatic increase in mitochondria in the rats. So it basically increases NRF1 and ultimately will increase mitochondrial number. And so this is like a normal nutrient situation, starvation, increased mitochondria. Like I said, NRF1 and NRF2 downstream of AMPK are you basically, in this particular experiment, you've decreased NRF2 using SHRM to basically knock down the expression of NRF2. And you can see that it's basically, so this is like a control. This these hash bars here, these are controls. knock down NR2, and you also decrease the TOM proteins, you decrease VDAC, you know, you decrease other mitochondrial proteins. So just by changing that one protein, NR2, you basically altered the whole energy metabolism of the mitochondrial cell. And this is showing that if you actually knock out, say you make a mouse that doesn't have AMPK at all, which is these lower two panels here, and this is a wild type mouse up here, you create a low energy situation. You can see that there's an increase in mitochondria in the wild type mouse. So this is like normal energy, depleted energy, more mitochondria. If AMPK is absent, nothing happens at all. Like there's no increase in mitochondria whatsoever. In fact, it even looks like they decrease there. And there's, you know, AMPK is like one of these targets now for metabolism and weight loss and so on and so forth. But it's, I think there are problems with it. You can look it up, like it's not so quite clear cut. I'm just trying to figure out how long I've got. 5 or 6 slides.
If you provide dinner for the students.
Oh, sure, yeah, everyone, it's all on me. We just got a couple more things. The mitochondria also involved in apoptosis. So there's basically two pathways of signaling in apoptosis: the intrinsic pathway and the extrinsic pathway. They're similar, but they're basically activated through different signals. If we take the intrinsic pathway as an example. Say it happens through cell damage, some kind of stress condition. You have a permeability transition in the inner mitochondrial membrane. So basically, the inner mitochondrial membrane opens, and eventually the outer as well. It basically releases the contents of the mitochondria into the cell. So the pores open. There's a, you know, proton gradient dissipates, and it releases several factors into the cytoplasm of the cell. And some of the most important are cytochrome C, apoptosis-inducing factors, and then enzymes called proteasomases. These are like proteolytic enzymes. They basically break down proteins in the cell. And there's like another cascade, essentially, of proteins in apoptosis. Cytochrome C, which is in that electron transport chain, activates a late caspase. That then activates other caspases. You basically have this cascade of protein degradation in the cell, massive protein degradation. It also destroys the nuclear lamins. And the chromatin, even the chromatin is broken down, initiated by this apoptosis-inducing factor, AIF. And these are the basic two mechanisms, extrinsic pathway, intrinsic pathway. The extrinsic here is the one that's really illustrated. And as usual, you don't need to memorize like all the individual steps. You do want to know that the extrinsic pathway is initiated through so-called death receptors that then activate caspase 8, which is the initiator of the caspase. And the effector caspase, caspase 3, and then that will eventually cause the disintegration of the proton gradient, the release of apoptosis-inducing factor. There'll be even more caspase activation. It's pointless to memorize every single step, but it's like important to realize that there are these initial steps. steps and the death receptor, caspase 8 and caspase 3 that ultimately result in cell death through apoptosis. And then lastly, really lastly this time, you've got a disease called, there's a disease called myotrophic lyrosclerosis, ALS. And you may have heard of it, it's affected several sort of well-known individuals. Lou Gehrig is one, Stephen Hawking is another. The prevalence is about 2 out of 100,000 in the population. And it's associated with mitochondrial damage in the neurons. And it turned out that the mutation is actually in an enzyme called superoxide dismutase, SOD. And that's normally something that's involved in detoxification of products of the electron transport chain. But in ALS, it's misfolded. Like in ALS is a misfolding of this SOD1, and it actually gums up VDAC. It blocks VDAC, so you can't get import nutrients and you can't get export of ATP. And molecularly, it basically causes like massive swelling of the cristae. You see how enlarged these cristae are here? And like inclusions in the mitochondria, buildup of toxicity. You can look through each of these. There's a description here of what of all these changes that are occurring. And you know, the net result is that you're not getting ATP being produced in neurons anymore. So the synapses are not going to work, the motor neurons stop working, and progressively over time, these individuals become effectively paralyzed. So that's ALS, and this last slide, it's also been shown that mitochondria involve in aging. So if you have mice that don't, their mitochondrial DNA polymerase is error prone. It will actually cause buildup of mutations in the mitochondrial DNA. And you get a failure again of ATP production in all cells in the body, which results in like this kyphosis in the mouse is characteristic of aging. You may say, well, why would that actually cause aging? I think it's that you need ATP for cell replication. You need it to maintain telomeres, so on. So if the mitochondria are damaged too much, you end up with the same result as, say, something like progeria. You've got no cell division occurring, like the failure of cell division. And that's what all these aging syndromes have in common. That's it. Thank you. Thank you for your patience. Yeah, is it? Were there some differences between?
Yeah, there is a
lot of this.
Don't worry about it. Like, who did I get the?
Oh, you
do. Yeah, do you want to do the second thing?
Yes.
Yeah.
No.
Okay.
Yes.
Great.
Thank you.
You're
break.